If you face blindness and it starts to seem as though your eyes are only good for crying and you're feeling all alone, come to a place of kindness and in a new way you will see that there's much more to hope than just learning to cope. You can live a life that's full and free where the Vision Resource Center, let us be your guiding light as we strive to keep your dreams alive. Even if you lose your sight, you're not alone. Pick up the phone, we help friends and family too. We're the Vision Resource Center for people affected by blindness and low vision. We're here for you.
Good morning and welcome to the January 2019 edition of Insight here on BCTV. I'd like to welcome you all to our show and hope you enjoy our program. My name is Mark Levengood, counselor at the Vision Resource Center of Berks County. And today we have a unique twist where instead of being the host, I will be the guest, and the president and CEO of Vision Resource Center, Lori Shermerhon, is with me, and she will be playing the role of the host, interviewing me about Boy Scouts with a visual impairment based upon my own experiences. So good morning, Lori. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Excellent. Thank you. So we're going to do a little role reversal here.
Sounds like a plan to me. So let's start with how you lost your vision.
So in February of 2003, just a couple weeks shy of my 16-year anniversary here, I was diagnosed with a brain tumor. And 2 days after my brain tumor diagnosis, I went into the operating room for biopsy brain tumor surgery. And when I went into the OR, I had vision. And when I woke up from the anesthesia, it was completely gone. And I've remained completely blind for, like I said, just under 16 years now.
Okay. So since we decided to do this program about Boy Scouts, when did you get involved with the Boy Scouts?
I was involved in my local scouting program since I was a little tiger cub in my tiny orange t-shirt. Cub Pack 367 in New Hanover and Gilbertsville, Pennsylvania. And first grade tiger cub on up.
And why did you choose to continue Boy Scouts after you lost your vision?
After I lost my vision, I unfortunately had to give up a lot of my other activities. Baseball was one of my biggest passions. I had done soccer and basketball, and you know, there are different sports and athletics for the visually impaired community, but I was not aware of them at the time. And scouting just seemed like a very doable activity for me, mm-hmm. despite not having vision. It just seemed to lend itself, to a visually impaired person continuing in that activity, that environment.
And how receptive were the adult leaders in your actual troop to helping you to experience and accommodate?
I was very fortunate to have a very strong troop. Again, Cub Pack 367 turned into Troop 367, and a phenomenal group of leaders. It was a really strong troop when I was there. I would say a good 30 to 35 boys and probably a good 15 or so adult leaders, and they were wonderful. I mean, from the scoutmaster on down to all of them, they really accommodated me, supported me on camping trips and various adventures, hikes, summer camp activities, and so forth. I mean, they were right there, whatever I needed, whether it was sighted assistance or sighted guide in terms of my mobility, whatever I needed, I mean, they were very supportive.
And what about the boys? You know, did the boys in your troop really help you out? And did you ever experience any bullying or teasing?
No, the boys were great. Likewise, you know, I lost my sight at 13 years old in eighth grade, as I said earlier. And, you know, at that point, I was already in the troop for a couple of years. My vision loss was a month shy of my 14th birthday. So I had already pretty much had a social niche within the troop, and that clique of boys that I really had already bonded with, and they just they realized pretty quickly that I was the same mark. I just couldn't see anymore, and I mean, nothing really ever changed. We had a very comical troop, both the leaders with the scouts and the scouts amongst themselves were frequently in jest, joking with one another, giving one another a hard time, and you know, great sense of humor within the troop. And so, you know, nothing malicious, no bullying or teasing or you know, of any, and nothing antagonistic.
Okay. So you talked a little bit about summer camp. What was your experience? What were you able to participate in? And, you know, with your visual impairment, what were the differences?
Sure. So in the, you know, of course, with Scouts, you're in Boy Scouts from, I think you cross over from Cubs into Boy Scouts in fifth grade, and then you remain a Boy Scout until you turn 18, and then you age out and become a man. So in the 4 years, four summers following my vision loss, I was able to attend two summer camp experiences. The other two, I had scheduling conflicts and other trips planned where I was unable to go. But the first summer, summer of 2003, just, let's see, that would have been about 5 months after losing my vision, I went off to scout camp for a week, and I'm pretty sure that scared my parents, specifically my mother. And but both when the summer of 2003 and the summer of 2005, I was able to do the summer camp experiences. My Boy Scout camp was Camp Nobi Bosco up in northern New Jersey. I think Nobi is an acronym. I think the county was like North Bergen or something. So that's what Nobi stands for. And then Boy Scout or Bosco was, of course, short for Boy Scout. So Camp Nobi Bosco, northern Jersey, that was always where I did my summer camp experiences with Troop 367, and wonderful experiences. Obviously, even though I was starting to learn orientation and mobility with the white cane, I had to do sighted guide. So for anyone that doesn't know, that basically means I had my cane in my right hand, and then I took the right elbow with my left hand of someone who was sighted, and they would just lead me all over the camp. Obviously a lot of gravel and loose stone walkways, paths, hiking trails, large random boulders and rocks and tree stumps. So, you know, it was a Boy Scout camp. So, you know, we had to be careful with the mobility and the traveling. But, you know, once we got through that, I mean, whether it was the leaders or my fellow scouts, they were able to help me with the travel. You know, I stopped participating in the swimming in the lake just for safety precautions. It just didn't seem like a wise idea to jump into a 15-foot deep lake. You know, I skipped that. And obviously my range experiences on the rifle shooting range ceased, or at least I thought it did. We'll get into that later, but you know, for the time being. But yeah, I had two wonderful years of summer camp at Nobi Bosco, despite not having vision. I went for I think 2 or 3 years with vision, and then 2 years without, and always wonderful experiences.
Awesome. What is Order of the Arrow? Can you explain that a little bit?
So Order of the Arrow is like a subset or a separate sect, a smaller sect of the Boy Scouts. And basically Order of the Arrow is an organization within the Boy Scouts community where it's very service oriented. A lot of service projects going on with the OA or Order of the Arrow. And in order to get involved in OA, Order of the Arrow, you have to reach a certain rank. Admittedly, I don't remember what that rank was, but even after you reach that rank, your fellow scouts need to elect or nominate you to do it. You need to have those certain characteristics in yourself that, you know, your fellow scouts say, yeah, he's worthy, and then they nominate or elect you to participate in the OA weekend. So again, that goes back to you asked earlier how the other scouts treated me. And when I was 16, sophomore in high school, I believe it was, I was nominated and elected to participate in Order of the Arrow. And so I went on my ordeal weekend. And after that ordeal weekend of service projects and some pretty labor-intensive tasks, I became an official member of Order of the Arrow. So
wonderful.
Yeah.
How about your vision loss? How did that fit in with your pursuit for your Eagle rank?
So for anyone who doesn't know the Scout ranks, I assume it's the same when I was in Scouts. I don't know if it changed in the last 10 years. But the ranks in Boy Scouts are Scout, Tenderfoot, Second Class, First Class, Star, Life, Eagle. Eagle, of course, being the pinnacle of the scouting world. And I was very fortunate to go through all of the lower ranks before losing my vision. So in reality, when I was 13 years old, I was already a Life Scout with only one rank to go. I reached the rank of Life Scout before losing my vision in February of 2003. So when I turned 14 in March of 2003, I had 4 years before I turned 18 and aged out to move one rank. And that was incredibly helpful to be able to, you know, methodically plot along, work through the requirements for Eagle, just having to move from Life to Eagle and be able to do it as health permitted, as time permitted, et cetera, taking 4 years basically to do it.
So were there other modifications that needed to be made for you because of the visual impairment on your Trail the Eagle?
I honestly don't remember any modifications. The only one that I can think of, which wasn't even a modification for me, there are a specific group of merit badges that a person has to get in order to get Eagle. So you have your elective merit badges, and then you have your required for Eagle merit badges. And in the required for Eagle category, you can either do life-saving or emergency preparedness. I was planning on doing life-saving, but then I lost my vision, and so by default, I switched over to emergency preparedness. Life-saving is very labor-intensive in a pool or lake-type situation, a lot of swimming. And after I lost my vision, my plan to do life-saving switched over to emergency preparedness, which was more writing and book knowledge and just, you know, writing out plans for any type of emergency situation. I'm guessing that if I would have lost my vision earlier in my scouting career as I was working toward Tenderfoot, Second Class, First Class, you know, I'm guessing some of those requirements would have been modified for me, but because I already had those requirements complete when my vision loss set in, I really didn't have to worry about modifications.
Okay. What about your Eagle Scout project? What was it and how did you make it happen?
Sure. So my former church owns a picnic grove a couple blocks down the road from the church setting. And that picnic grove is actually where my scout troop met in the summertime. We would meet at the church in the winter, and then we would be at the picnic grove in the summertime. And in the picnic grove, all the walkways were loose stones, gravel, lots of tree roots, etc. And so anyone with wheelchairs or walkers or canes would have had great difficulty navigating. And the church, of course, used that picnic grove for several activities throughout the year, obviously mostly in the summertime. And those loose stone gravelly walkways led right into the restrooms. So it did make for difficult navigating. So what I did was I excavated an entire pathway and patio area and installed a brick paver patio walkway leading right to the restrooms, which helped with the mobility and it helped with the accessing the restrooms for anyone who does use a wheelchair or a walker. Now to do that project, it did cost, I don't remember the exact number, but I think the project was somewhere between $10,000 and $12,000. So in order to raise the money to do it, I sold bricks to the community. I partnered with a local engraver. And so anyone from the community who wanted to buy a brick, they got to have the message of their choice engraved in the stone. So we sold several hundred bricks with engraved messages, a lot of people's names in memory of, Bible scripture passages, all kinds. Anything someone wanted engraved in a stone, we made it happen. People paid for it, and as a result, the entire Eagle Project paid for itself just by selling bricks to the community. A lot of people got excited when they heard that their name could be engraved in stone.
So you did make Eagle,
yes,
the rank of Eagle.
Yep.
So what was that ceremony like for you?
So I completed my Eagle Board of Review on December 29th, 2006. I then turned 18 just a couple months later in March, so I did successfully make it. And that spring, we had my Eagle Scout ceremony, and that was a pretty epic experience. My parents graciously went all out for me. We filled the sanctuary of that church, both the floor seating as well as the balcony. We had music. It was a huge ceremony. The organist played a couple hymns that were very special to me, and a lot of speakers, a lot of presentation, and it was definitely one of the true highlights of my growing up, of my life overall, but definitely of my teenage years, no doubt.
So we're going to skip around a little bit because
sure,
we're running a little short here. So do you think with having your visual impairment that you missed out on anything or any parts of the scouting experience?
No, I think if anything, it really enhanced my experiences. It helped me to connect with the leaders and the boys on a deeper level. Obviously, I was more reliant on them for the full experience. But I mean, if I had to really be nitpicky, the only thing that maybe I missed out on was, for example, going to like Philmont out in New Mexico. I'm sure if I would have pressed, you know, and really showed an interest in making that happen, I'm sure there would have been a way to modify or accommodate that. But after I lost my vision with my different health issues, Philmont just kind of fell by the wayside. Or, you know, I know there's a scuba-oriented experience down in Florida that I've heard about.
Seabase.
Yep, Seabase. I think if I would have had vision, maybe I would have pushed to pursue something like that. You know, but aside for something like Seabase or Philmont, which most scouts don't even participate in those are really above and beyond experiences. No, my vision loss did not take away from my scouting experience.
Favorite memories?
Oh boy. Well, going back to Cub Scouts, when I had vision, I would say two memories stand out. I had a week-long camping experience with my dad at Camp Heart, which I think is local to Berks County. I can't remember exactly where that is, but that was an incredible week of fun with my dad and the other boys and their dads, as well as, again, Cub Scouts winning the Pinewood Derby one year. That was pretty epic for my dad and I, who, you know, joined to make the car. When I got to the Boy Scouts, again, when I had vision, we took a week-long trip up to the Adirondack Mountains. Again, my dad was on the trip for that one, and that was just a really neat experience. I was definitely a younger scout for that trip, again, having vision. And so it was an opportunity for me to really look up to the older boys, see how to run a camping experience, up in upstate New York. And that was an incredible week of very memorable experiences. Another very memorable experience, it was actually my last camping trip before I lost my vision, January of 2003, the Klondike Derby. It was so, so very cold that weekend. I think it was in the single digits over at night, in the teens during the day. And I'll tell you, I did not prepare with adequate clothing. And when my parents dropped me off at the church, I later found out that my mom said to my dad, he's not equipped enough for this. He doesn't have the right amount or the right quality of clothing. And my dad said, I know, he'll learn. It'll be a memorable experience and he'll learn from it. And boy, did I ever. But yeah, certainly very memorable. And then obviously the Eagle Scout experience, huge. I mean, that's the pinnacle for any scout. So certainly there. But the one last memory that I want to share is my final year at summer camp, which would have been 2005. I alluded to this earlier. I actually had an opportunity, despite being completely blind, to go for my rifle shooting merit badge. And every year I'd go to camp, it was the comical running joke. Who's going to be the poor guy that holds the target that says, over here, Mark, shoot this way? But the range master heard about my story. He wanted to make it happen. They modified it all. And not only did I complete the rifle shooting merit badge totally blind, but he gave me an opportunity to go skeet shooting, and I shot 40% accuracy. And he gave me an opportunity to shoot archery and even a black powder muzzle loader. So I like to think that with that being my last year summer camp, literally and figuratively, I went out with a bang.
Absolutely. And Mark, I just want to thank you because as a mom of a Boy Scout who is hopefully going to get his Eagle Scout, you truly are an inspiration. So thank you for sharing.
Certainly.
Do you want to close the show now?
Sure, sure. So just so everyone is aware, we do have our annual events coming up on January the 16th. We'll be taking our monthly lunch bunch outing to Mimo's Restaurant and Pizzeria. On January 23rd, we'll have our monthly sight loss support group at the Vision Resource Center. And then on February 6th, we'll be showing a descriptive movie of a Broadway classic, and we'll be doing lunch that day as well. So February 6th will be our social recreational activity. If anyone wants to attend these events, please call me, Mark Levengood, at 610-375-8407, extension 120. And we hope you can make it. We do hope that you enjoyed the program today, and for anyone who's interested in scouting, don't let vision impairment or any other limitation stop you, because it is absolutely doable and a wonderful experience. And I definitely credit the Boy Scouts and my experiences with them for helping me to become the man that I am today. Wonderful memories and lifelong experiences. So with that, we thank you for joining us. Wish you all a very happy and safe 2019, and we look to see you in February. Thanks so much.
Insight on BCTV is supported by the Vision Resource Center.